My name is Robin Means Coleman, and I'm chair of the Department of Communication Studies, and so I welcome guests of the department in this happy event. In 2013, the Department of Communication Studies entered into an intellectually rewarding partnership with the Pulitzer Center on Crisis Reporting. The Pulitzer Center is an award-winning nonprofit journalism organization dedicated to advancing independent, international journalism and promoting in-depth engagement with global affairs. We are the beneficiaries of their dedication to educational programming, as the Pulitzer Center is bringing us this incredible discussion today. They also support our students right here at the University of Michigan by providing them with international journalism experience. At the core of this excellent work is Tom Hunley, senior editor at the Pulitzer Center. Before joining the Pulitzer Center, Tom was a newspaper journalist for 36 years, including nearly two decades as a foreign correspondent for the Chicago Tribune. During that time, he served as the Tribune's bureau chief in Jerusalem, Warsaw, Rome, and London, reporting from more than 60 countries. He has covered three wars: the Persian Gulf, the Arab-Israeli conflict, and the rise of Iran's post-revolutionary theocracy. Tom has also been a National Endowment for the Humanities Journalism Fellow right here at the University of Michigan. Tom has worked closely with our featured speaker, Uri Blau, who is investigating how tax-exempt dollars raised in the U.S. ended up sustaining Jewish settlements in the West Bank in direct contravention of U.S. policy. Please give a very warm welcome to Tom.
Thanks very much, Robin. Just very briefly about the Pulitzer Center. We're a donor-supported nonprofit news organization, and what we do basically is give grants to journalists who want to do the kind of reporting that mainstream news organizations say they can no longer afford, mainly international reporting. We also do extensive educational outreach, and we're honored that the University of Michigan has been one of our partners for the last 3 years. I'm delighted to be here today, and I'm delighted to see this full house, and that you're all willing to brave the viral epidemic that seems to be sweeping the campus. Well, now it's my pleasure to introduce the two people that you came to hear. First, Juan Cole. Juan is the Richard P. Mitchell Collegiate Professor of History here at the University of Michigan. And I don't think he needs too much of an introduction in these precincts, but I will say that for more than three decades, he has brought one of the more refined and nuanced voices to the conversation about the Middle East. He's the author of several books, most recently, The New Arabs, How the Wired and Global Youth of the Middle East is Transforming It. Juan has been a regular guest on PBS NewsHour, one of our frequent partners, and has also appeared on ABC Nightly News, Nightline, The Today Show, Charlie Rose, Anderson Cooper 360, Countdown with Keith Olbermann, The Colbert Report, Democracy Now!, and many others. He's written widely about Egypt, Iran, Iraq, South Asia. He's commented extensively on Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, the Iraq War, the politics of Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iran. And I can tell you from personal experience as a foreign correspondent for more than 20 years that his blog, Informed Comment, which was born shortly after 9/11, is must reading for any journalist who is serious about covering the Middle East and wants to understand and think and write clearly about this region. Our other guest is Uri Blau. Uri is an investigative journalist from Israel specializing in military and political affairs. He started his career at the tender age of 17 in 1994 at the Jerusalem Weekly Kol Ha'ir, and in 2005 he joined Haaretz, Israel's most influential daily newspaper. During his years as a working journalist, Uri has uncovered a number of high-profile corruption cases involving top government officials, including Israeli Foreign Affairs Minister Avigdor Lieberman, and former Prime Ministers Ehud Barak and Ehud Olmert. Uri himself was at the center of a national security scandal after his investigation revealed that the Israeli military had conducted and covered up unlawful targeted assassinations of Palestinians in the West Bank. For this, he became the first journalist in Israel to be charged under the Espionage Act for possession of classified information. Uri accepted a plea bargain in the case, after which Freedom House, the respected human rights group, downgraded Israel from free to partially free in its 2013 Freedom of the Press Index. 2 years ago, Uri was a Nieman Fellow at Harvard University, and his work has been published by The Washington Post, ProPublica, Quartz, The Nation, and Foreign Policy. So the format tonight, or this afternoon, is a conversation between Uri and Juan, and the general topic will be America's relationship with Israel. The program will run for about 90 minutes, and we will include plenty of time at the end for your questions and comments, but no rants. To get started, I want to show you a very brief video in which Uri talks about his most recent investigative project about how hundreds of millions of dollars raised by U.S. nonprofits ended up funding Jewish settlements in the West Bank.
My name is Uri Blau, and I'm an Israeli investigative journalist. I've identified and mapped the American nonprofits that are forwarding money to Israeli settlements and organizations that are operating in the West Bank across the Green Line. The idea was to understand how much tax-deductible money arrives from the U.S. to support Israeli settlements. I've been dealing with this topic for years now, covering the situation in Israel, and I've noticed that there is a significant effect of American dollars on the ground in Israel. In 1967, Israel occupied the West Bank, and since then it's been, 48 years now, it established more than 100 settlements in the West Bank. Today, a few hundred thousand Israelis live in that occupied land. According to the international law, the settlements are illegal. You're not supposed to move population into an occupied land. The fact that the Israeli military need to protect those settlers means that the Palestinians who live there encounter military presence basically on a daily basis. Now, the American administration, ever since 1967, officially says that Israel is opposing the settlement movement in Israel. But it seems that it's easier said than done, because what this investigation found out is that American taxpayers are basically indirectly subsidizing the settlement movement in Israel. The figures I came up with after recognizing almost 50 nonprofits in the US that are raising money here and forwarding it to communities across the Green Line in the West Bank, the figures are striking. In 5 years, between 2009 and 2013, the revenue of those 50 organizations exceeds $280 million. More than $220 million were forwarded to settlement. Now, this money supports all sorts of causes. It does anything from building synagogues and the yeshiva school, religious schools. It can help build playground for kids. But it also helped purchasing houses of Palestinians in very dense villages in East Jerusalem. Most striking than that is probably the fact that this money helped support Jews who've been convicted in acts of violence against Palestinians, ideological motivated violence. So, for example, wife of a Jewish guy who murdered 7 Palestinians in 1990 received financial aid from an organization that receives money from the US. So that's an indirect support in people who've conducted the most horrendous crimes. I think people should learn that they shouldn't take for granted what politicians, what the administration here tell them. On one hand, the administration is saying he's against the settlement. But the other end of this very same administration is feeding those settlements he's opposed to.
Could I get some water? Sorry. Well, welcome everybody. Is this thing working?
Yes.
Welcome. Thank you for having us. Me.
Yeah. Well, it's wonderful to have you on campus, Uri. Thanks so much to Robin and the communications department and the Pulitzer, Tom Hunley, and setting all this up, for the kind invitation and the kind words. But the really great thing, well, I'm like the poor, you have me always with you, but today we have Uri, who is an eyewitness to a lot of very important things that are shaping our world. And so I thought I'd begin with his latest series of reports, which he has talked about in that film, and try to get more detail out of this. And the first thing to say is that, as he said in the film, the practice of flooding Israelis into Palestinian territory is illegal. The partition of Palestine in 1948 was anticipated by the UN General Assembly, and they did make a map. What happened in reality was not exactly what they envisaged. But ironically enough, that map and the way things worked out were such that the places where Jews had settled in historic Palestine under the British Mandate tended to end up in their hands. The places where they hadn't tended to end up as Palestinians. So there had been, aside from Jerusalem itself, almost no Jews in what is now the West Bank before 1940. And likewise, Gaza was not a place that they settled. And something on the order of 720,000 Palestinians were expelled from their homes during the war, often quite deliberately by the Zionist forces. They were ethnically cleansed. And ended up in Gaza and the West Bank. So in 67, when Israel conquered Gaza and the West Bank, many of the Palestinians that then came under Israeli military rule had already been expelled from their homes in what became Israel. So many of the Palestinians in Gaza, something like 70% of the families, you know, originated in what is now Sederot and Beersheba and so forth. And the same thing happened on the West Bank. Well, it's not illegal for one country to occupy territory of another country during wartime in international law. But there is a body of law that has grown up which talks about what the obligations of an occupying power are. And you can't, like, starve the local population or target civilians for mistreatment if the occupying power meets armed resistance. It can try to deal with that, but it can't use disproportionate or indiscriminate force. And then all through the 20th century, from the Hague Agreement of 1907 through the Geneva Conventions, it has been argued that it's illegal for the occupying power to to attempt to annex the occupied territory, to flood its population into it. And this is in the United Nations Charter, to which Israel and the United States and so forth are signatories. The Charter says one country may not fight a war, take territory from another, and then incorporate it into itself. No more, you know, Axis-style activities of conquering other countries and taking them over. So the occupation should be temporary, and then there are rules for how it should be conducted. Israel is in profound violation of every single article of the Geneva Accords. And remember, the Geneva Accords after World War II were set up to try to stop there from being more World War IIs or more Axis-style activities. So violating the Geneva Accords is a very serious thing, in my view. There isn't very much teeth to the Geneva Accords, but the United States, as Uri says in his introduction, does take the position that the squatting on Palestinian land in the West Bank, and they used to do it in Gaza, is illegal. But it's all just talk. This is the point of your story.
No, not necessarily.
Okay.
First, I think I wouldn't know if it's very accurate to call what happened in 1948 ethnic cleansing, but I don't know if we want to go there. I think it's probably more complicated than this. It was obviously horrible things were done in the war, but it's more complicated. I don't think it was an ethnic cleansing, but not sure if we want to enter to this debate now. But you tell me. You
can. Well, you're welcome to disagree about 48.
Yeah.
You tell us about now.
Yeah, exactly. So in 1967, Israel entered to war and basically occupied the West Bank. And in the years that follow, Jewish settlers started to move across the Green Line. Eventually, they moved there with the support of the State of Israel. There's no doubt about it. And today, we are talking about more than 300,000 Jewish settlers in the West Bank and 200-something thousand that lives in East Jerusalem. Now, it's true that America, the U.S., is opposing the settlement movement officially, and President Obama said that it's not a legitimate movement. And this article just saw the hypocrisy of it all. So I think this is one key point. Now in Israel, there is a lot of talk about the liberal organizations and how much money they get from abroad. So in recent years, there's more and more discussion as Israel centers move more to the right. There is more discussion about freedom of speech and the ability of liberal and human rights organizations to freely operate. Organizations such as Breaking the Silence, who bring the testimonies of soldiers to the public knowledge, or B'Tselem, who follow human rights violations, etc. So those organizations get the majority of their funds from abroad, usually from Europe. Many times it would be a state-funded organization that fund them. So we're talking about, so the right wing in Israel said, look, you are patching Israel with foreign money. It's foreign influence on like you're trying to influence the policy of Israel with foreign funds. And for me, it was important to show, I've been following this story for years, but there wasn't any concrete set of data about like where the settlement movement gets its money. Obviously, the majority of the money come from like the State of Israel. This $220 million we are talking about, it really is peanuts when you think about overall price, economical price of occupation. But it definitely helps them sustain a better quality of life. I would say it's many times it would support a more luxury style of life. And to begin with, it's a fairly well-off community. It depends where. But like generally speaking, the settlers are more well off. Also because they get a lot of support from the State of Israel. And that was the point of the story, to understand where do the settlers get the money from, and to show the hypocrisy, the American policy in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, if there are 500,000 settlers and they got $280 million, $220 million, that's about $500 a piece over those 5 years, right?
Sure, sure. So I think more than the money, like more than the amount of the money, it's the principle of it. So if the U.S. opposes the settlements, why does it support it?
Yeah. Of course, $500 is nothing to sneeze at. That would be nice if we could all get each $500. So tax policy in the United States is not made by the State Department. These organizations that are sending money to the squatter settlements on the West Bank are recognized as 501c3 charities. That's done by the Department of Treasury. There's not a lot of follow-up. So, you know, a 501c3, the University of Michigan is one, has a special tax status. It doesn't have to pay taxes. There are some restrictions, like you're not supposed to have that status if you're a partisan organization. So the Democratic Party can't be a 501c3. But there are very large numbers, in my view, of 501c3 charities, which are in fact partisan in their activities, and quite openly so. And the Internal Revenue Service almost never goes back and checks them. It follows up on what are they doing. Do they still deserve this status? I think they'd have to be sued by somebody.
They actually are. There's a big lawsuit that was just filed in December, very soon after the series of article was published. It's a group of mainly, I think, Washington DC based plaintiff. Did you hear about it?
No, I haven't.
So it's Palestinian, it's Americans who are of Palestinian origin, mainly, that sues basically asks the court to make the US Treasury follow those regulations and stop financing not only settlements. They are talking about so many other institutions, from Friends of the IDF to Birthright, I think, and many other institutions. I think that, from my understanding, IRS is when I approached the White House and the State Department, they were affirming their opinions that they are opposing the settlement movement, but they did refer to the IRS. IRS says, look, if there is no law broken, we can't do much. There are no regulations in the IRS that forbid transferring money across the green line. It just doesn't exist.
No.
So you can support, like, there are particular organizations that you are not supposed to support. You definitely cannot support terrorist organizations. But I think the IRS is also reluctant to a certain extent or to a certain degree to deal with this issue, because the Tea Party scandal that they faced a few years ago. So they don't want to enter this minefield. However, a few complaints have been filed really in recent months, besides this lawsuit, against to the IRS regarding support in particular organization that was revealed in the investigation. And I think those complaints might have more chance to, I think there is, like, if you ask me, I don't think the IRS is going to change its policy generally, but I think if there are examples of particular causes, very problematic causes that are funded by US tax exempt dollars, such as dollars that goes to the family, to families of Jewish terrorists, Jews who attack Palestinians out of ideologically motivated reasons. So those kind of funds are really problematic, and I think the IRS might agree with that stand. Mm-hmm. If money, another, I think, very concrete example and problematic one is the Hebron Fund. So how many of you guys have been to Israel, Palestine? Oh, so it's a crowd that knows probably Hebron very well. And you know how it's a very segregated place, very sad, a lot of tension, restrictions on Palestinians. Hundreds of shops have been closed in order to allow the Jewish community over there to thrive, while the Palestinian one is really dying, like economically. And the Hebron settlement, the Jewish settler in Hebron, are heavily supported by tax-exempt donations that come from Brooklyn, the Hebron Fund. The head of the Hebron Jewish community a couple of years ago was a guy called Menachem Livni. Menachem Livni was a member in a Jewish organization group that operated at the beginning of the 80s called the Jewish Underground. And it was like a terrorist organization. They conducted an assault on the Islamic college in Hebron, killing 3 students, if I remember correctly. And they tried to assassinate several mayors in the West Bank. Livni and 2 other guys were sentenced to life in prison. And they were released, they were pardoned by the then president of Israel, Chaim Herzog, and were released after less than 7 years. And Livni was appointed as the CEO of the Hebron community. His salary, hundreds of thousands of shekels, so like tens of thousands of dollars, came from the US. So it was like you guys that supported his salary. This is something very concrete, very problematic, that I think might have a chance to, like, if people complain, and people did complain, it might change.
Mm. I'm not sure. One of the problems with we've found with suits about these kinds of issues is that in American law, it's very important that the judge recognize the plaintiff as having standing to sue. And standing is actually hard to get. So you have to prove that you personally or your class have been damaged by this activity. So actually, I couldn't sue over this, because I could never prove to a judge that I had standing to sue.
Sure.
If you had an American Palestinian family who were in some way were injured, maybe if the judge were sympathetic to them, and that's a very big if, they might be granted standing. So my guess is that that lawsuit will be dismissed.
My guess is the same as yours.
Yeah. And then our Congress is so anti-Palestinian that it may well just recognize the West Bank as part of Israel. And there are some writers in a current bill that's before Obama that have the effect of for economic exchange purposes.
You know, every election circle here, when they talk about Israel, then typically it would be the Republican that say, okay, if you support Israel so much, then why don't you move the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem? But then it haven't happened. So I would say it's probably more complicated than this. Because if they were like all for annexing the West Bank, then they could have done it already. Like, they could have supported something as symbolic as moving the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. So definitely, like, they can talk about it, but then, like, to actually do it, I mean, you had enough Republican presidents here that could have done it and didn't do it, so.
Well, of course, there's pushback from other sides.
Sure.
Bush administration was very close to Saudi Arabia, and this would have angered Riyadh, and so there were reasons not to do it. But there are, I don't know if you have met our new Congress. There are many members of it who are unconstrained by such considerations. And as I said, there is at the moment a bill before Obama that would recognize Israeli settlement economic activity as legitimate, as explicitly legitimate. And so I think that would make it impossible also to address this issue of the NGOs giving money there.
If it will pass, which I doubt.
It has passed. The question is if Obama will sign it.
Yeah, but like that Obama won't sign something like this, I would assume.
We think he may.
Really? Mm. Okay, so we'll have to wait and see. I mean,
they put it in the other, they put it as a rider in other bills that it's important for him to pass in an election year. So Yeah, it's not that he supports it.
But only recently, there was, really a couple of weeks ago, there was a discussion about marking products that come from the West Bank. And the U.S. Custom basically renewed an order that was issued like 20-something years ago. And then Israel suddenly is like, oh, why do you ask to do it again? Like, why all of a sudden now? So I think this this movement goes both ways.
Sure.
And
it's true. However, over time, the Israeli settlements on Palestinian land in the West Bank have become more and more regularized with regard to the United States. The economic dimension of this is, you know, in the 1970s it would have been out of the question, but more and more it's recognized, and it's little incremental victories that the right wing in Israel has in the U.S. Congress add up over a long period of time, and this is not just a matter of the settlements. So, for instance, there are riders on U.S. provision of arms to Israel that they can't be used for certain purposes, or certain kinds of weapons shouldn't be used, so they're not supposed to use cluster bombs. They dropped 1 million cluster bombs on South Lebanon in 2006, and those were American, and they were provided by the United States, and by the strict letter of American law, that should have provoked a congressional review and sanctions and action, and it all went away. So I don't know. I'm more cynical about this process.
No, usually I'm the pessimistic one in every conversation. Yeah. So I'm not sure what to say. But I just really think it's like it's more complicated, and it goes like sometimes the wind blows that direction, and other times the other way. And definitely there are more and more talk, even within U.S. campuses, about BDS. I think Israelis feel more isolated because of this conversation. And there's more, you describe one thing, but I just say like that there are other movements that exist out there. And
yes, that's true. And it's important to underline that the sort of more right-wing elements of the Israel lobbies often lose. I mean, this is part of what you're saying. So they didn't want the Iran deal at all, and they pulled out all of the stops to make sure it didn't go through. They lost. And I think in order to have a rational conversation about these issues, that really has to be acknowledged, as you say. It's a back and forth. It's at the margins. There are big losses on one side or the other. Let's back up. And you mentioned the labeling of goods from the squatter communities on the West Bank. I'm calling them squatters because I think that's what they are. And it's my little tinkering with language, because settlements in American history are good. We settled the West, and it was just as empty as the West Bank is.
Yeah, that's always a problem. No, that's always a problem, because how would you... There's no real other word for this, because like communities within Israel are also like settlements in a way, but not in that political meaning that we have for those across the Green Line.
Well, these squatters settle, as I said, you know, in Israel proper, the Jewish National Fund bought up a lot of land, and so when they make settlements on it, they own that. But in what's going on in the West Bank is some Palestinian family has deed to property, which is pre-48, and the Israeli courts will say, well, we don't recognize that, and then somebody will just grab it. I mean, they're stealing people's land, and then building on it. And endowing it with billions of dollars worth of worth. And the Palestinians have no recourse. What would you do if your land is taken?
Yeah, that's a fairly accurate description of things that definitely happen on ground. Again, that's very unfortunate. I think the U.S. ambassador to Israel very recently said that Israelis and Palestinians in the West Bank have different set of rules and laws, which is definitely the case. So again, a criticism that was highly noted in Israel. I think it came too late, but at least it came.
So the European Union has made a rule that things made by the squatter settlements in the West Bank by the Israelis who are on Palestinian land may be imported into Europe, but they have to be so labeled, because the European Union gives Israeli goods certain accommodations, in general, European governments, I think, want Israel to succeed, and maybe there's a certain amount of guilt about how they treated Jews and so forth. But for whatever reason, the Israeli-made goods have advantages in the European market. And there's also a lot of European exchange of technology and science. And I mean, Israel is an honorary member of the EU, the European Union, for certain purposes like this, which is an enormous benefit, because Israel is a small place, but it has a highly educated population, has a lot of scientists and engineers, and so the more they can share technological and scientific knowledge with Europe, the better they can succeed. The Europeans are starting to make this distinction between Israel proper and the West Bank in their practices. So they're now saying the goods that come from the West Bank, made by Israelis on Palestinian land, can't be given the same accommodation as the goods from Israel proper. And moreover, that they should be labeled, so that if somebody doesn't want to buy something made, you know, basically with stolen resources, that they wouldn't have to. The Israeli government went ballistic about this, and they, you know, withdrew ambassadors and called ambassadors on the mat, and went to see the European Union officials, and it's coming out of the European Parliament to some extent, and they are not so open to being lobbied as I think maybe if Prime Minister Netanyahu went to a president or prime minister in Europe and said, please don't do this to us, it's going to hurt us, and so forth, he might be able to make some headway. But if you got some 600, you know, members of the European Parliament from all over the place, so far Israel has not been able to find a way to get through to them. And so this policy has gone through. It hasn't been successfully opposed by Israel. And as you intimated, the U.S. State Department was asked about it and said, no, it's the right policy. So they took the side against Israel on this.
They did.
You're talking about money going, tax-exempt money, basically. Tax-exempt money means that you and I are paying for it, going to these squatter settlements, but so are people. And it's unclear. I saw a report that estimated maybe 15% of the squatters are Americans. Do you have any sense at all of whether that might be true?
Yeah, that might be true. It sounds about right, but I can't confirm, fact check it. I'll have to fact check this figure. But definitely when you go in certain settlements, you see a very thriving sometimes American community. For example, in Efrat, which is the largest settlement in Gush Etzion, just outside Jerusalem, it's a very Anglo-Saxon community. When you go to the supermarket, you'll find products that you don't see anywhere else in Israel, like all the Cheerios that you can find here in supermarket, you'll get suddenly in Efrat. So that's kind of interesting. In general, the settlement population is fairly diverse. So you've got the hardcore ideological settlers, and those would be the one usually in Samaria and also sometimes in places like Gush Etzion. But then during the 90s, when the big wave of immigration from Russia, there was a very big wave of immigration from Russia, there was not so many housing. The prices of housing all over Israel went really up. And big part of the Orthodox population in Israel was victim of this rising houses prices. So those people who live in Jerusalem or in Bnei Brak usually have very big families, and they are poor to begin with, and they just couldn't support themselves. So the government built settlements for those communities. So today, since like early to mid 90s, the biggest settlements are actually inhabited by ultra-Orthodox people who didn't move across the gray line for ideological reason, but like those would be economical settlers. 20 years after, definitely some people changed their view and became, I would assume, and I think that's the case, more right-wing and more ideological, but they didn't go there for that reason. And then in a place like Ariel, which is the only city in the West Bank, only Jewish city in the West Bank, you'll get those Russian immigrants. And, you know, kosher food or halal, like Jewish people have a lot of restrictions on what they can eat and cannot eat. But you go to a supermarket in Ariel, I love supermarkets, as you can understand, and then you'll suddenly see rabbit this is like a very non-kosher, and like any bacon you can imagine in a settlement.
Mm. Pork and vodka.
And many of them won't be even Jewish. So I remember I was there once before Christmas, and you see Christmas trees and decoration, and it's kind of funny.
Well, in the 90s, after the fall of the Soviet Union, something on the order of a million people went to Israel from the former Soviet Union or the former East Bloc. We don't think more than about half of them were Jewish. So they were economic migrants.
Maybe third, I think, was the general...
A third Jewish?
A third non-Jewish.
A third non-Jewish.
The way that Israel decide who it, like everything in Israel, there was a big debate about it.
Yeah.
But according to the religion, like you need to have a Jewish mother in order to be considered a Jewish person. But the state law is different. And it's you need only to have one Jewish grandfather or mother from one side in order to be considered Jewish and be granted with citizenship right away when you immigrate to Israel. Israel doesn't have, like this is part of the problem, Israel doesn't have an immigration policy. The only immigration policy exists for Jewish people. So if you're Jewish, you can become a citizen. If you're not, go figure, really.
In the census, there are on the order of 300,000 or so citizens of Israel who think that they're Jewish, but who are not so recognized by the Grand Rabbi.
Exactly. So you'll have citizens of Israel, people who would, in Israel, the most definitive part of being Israeli is serving the military. So, and you'll have like crazy thing, like, Russian, soldiers of Russian origin would serve the military and, people can die, but then they won't be buried in a Jewish cemetery. So they cannot be, there's no separation between religion and state in Israel, religious and state in Israel. So there's no civil marriage, or so Jews have to be married with Jews and Muslim with Muslim, etc. So they cannot be mixed, the state will acknowledge mixed religion marriage, but it won't approve them. So people will have to fly to Cyprus. So, and it's a huge problem for the Russian population.
Yeah. From a Palestinian point of view, a great irony that these people came 15 years ago from Russia and Ukraine, and they're living on the West Bank in subsidized housing, and on land taken from Palestinians who had been there rather longer. I wanted to get into another piece of reporting that you did before we wrap up on the conflict over solar panels in the West Bank.
Yeah, it's a fascinating story, actually. I recently found out that the settlement have a new revenue, a new way of making money, basically. They built up big solar fields in the West Bank on occupied land, which raised kind of the question of who owns the sun and like who owns the products of the sun. The solar energy is later sold to the Israeli electrical company. So this is really a source of revenue for settlements. Now the settlements receive all their they are fully connected to all the infrastructure from Israel. So they receive electricity, they receive water, they receive everything from the state of Israel. Now, this was the beginning, and it's just like interesting to see the new source of income for settlement. And it does raise interesting question about natural resources in occupied land, etc. But then it's become even more like complicated and like, I don't know, how should I define it? But next to those settlers, you'll see Palestinian communities. And many times those communities, the West Bank is divided to three areas, A, B, and C. A is like full Palestinian autonomy, B is Israel is partially in charge, and C, Israel is in full control even on the Palestinians that live in Area C. So Area C would be the area where Jewish settlers live, and there is like about 100,000 Palestinians that live in that area, so under full control of Israel. Now those people many times live in the harshest of conditions. I traveled to the South Hebron Mountain, where Palestinians still live in caves. I don't know if any of you have been in this place. It really is amazing. And those caves are not connected to electricity. It's not necessarily cave, but like even the other communities of the Palestinians are not connected, not to the Israeli electrical grid or to the Palestinian one. They won't have water coming. And whenever they would try to put new solar panel just for their own personal use, not to sell it, not to do anything, not to make profit out of it, just like to get, you know, their water heated or whatever usage of electricity that they need, they just can't get permission from the authorities, the civil administration, to build those solar panels. And time and again, Israel will come and destroy those solar panels or threaten to destroy them, and they'll have to fight it over court. The same goes with water. So water wells are being destroyed by Israel and water tanks are being confiscated. And the gap between it really is like, it's kind of amazing. You'll see like a settlement with its red roofs and like brick walls and bunch of solar panels on the top of the roof, and then the settlers live just next to falling shades of Palestinians who are not connected to nothing and cannot get the permission to be connected to electricity or water. Now another interesting aspect of the story was that it's actually American companies that are building the settlement solar panel fields. So Sun Edison, for example, held shares in one of the companies, in a subsidiary of a company that built in Jewish settlement. And there were other companies involved in it. So that was the story.
Yeah, I thought it was a wonderful piece of reporting because it demonstrated this infrastructural inequality between the two communities in the Palestinian West Bank, and how law and regulation and access to basic water and electricity resources is so different between the two. You know, before we close and go to questions, that's our bell. So I just did want to ask you one more thing.
Sure.
Which is that, you know, there are some news aggregation organizations that give news from the West Bank. This news does not appear typically in American newspapers, and sometimes, but not very regularly or in a connected way. And it never, ever, ever, ever appears on US television news. So one of them, let me just read some headlines from today and yesterday. Israeli army kidnaps four Palestinians in the West Bank. This is a pro-Palestinian site, so they said kidnapped rather than detained. Clashes in Yabad after Israeli soldiers invaded it. Palestinian worker suffers a leg fracture after Israeli soldiers assaulted him. Al-Qiq, a journalist who's been arrested and detained without charges, although the Israelis say that he has a connection to Hamas, is on a hunger strike. More demolitions in West Bank and Gaza. 22 striking teachers detained by Palestinian Authority security. Palestinian worker injured near Bethlehem. It goes on and on and on. Arrests, clashes, woundings, detentions, hunger strike. This looks to me like a low-intensity civil war in the West Bank. I don't think that the American public has any idea of how tense the situation really is. So am I exaggerating the situation? And where does this go? I mean, as you say, sometimes there's a certain back and forth in these historical developments, but it seems to me like there could be a really big blow up here.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, in terms of, you know, the information flow, you aggregate this news, so like you can get it here, but you need to be interested in order to get it. Obviously, you know, you won't hear about every demonstration. I think sometimes, as you said, kidnapped is like, it means like it's not very reliable if you choose to define it like this. So you can't expect, I think, even a major newspaper to receive the information from those kind of sources. I would assure you that Israelis don't know this as well. So it's not only an American thing. Those are Palestinian news. And like, I think it's more of a problem that Israelis are not aware of what's happening just 5 minutes away from their house rather than 6,000 miles away. I think big part of the problem is the lack of information within the Israeli society and the lack of desire to know. I mean, people really, even if you try to bring them the information, they don't want to know. This is why they go out against like breaking the silence kind of movement or against the Haaretz, because we are telling the story of the other side, even though breaking the silence or Haaretz doing a completely different job, but both for this kind of organization, it is important for the people of Israel to know, this is why I do what I do, because I think like the society needs a mirror in front of her face to know what's being done on her behalf. And where does it go? That's a great question. I mean, it's been going on for, you know, over 100 years, and it doesn't seem that it's going anywhere good. In that sense, I'm as pessimistic as you.
Okay. Well, on that happy note,
yeah.
I'd like to open it to questions and have some audience participation. However, as Tom, much more politely than I, intimated, no speeches, and we will cut you off if you just want to get up and give the whole talk backwards from a different point of view or something like that. So, you know, this is a precious resource. Uri's time, his journalism, his experience in this field, he knows things we don't know. He's coming and reporting to us as an eyewitness and as somebody who's extremely knowledgeable. So, If you're wise, you'll take advantage of this by asking him a pointed question or two. Yes, sir.
I have a question about the charities. So to go back to the charities. And I don't think you guys have talked about it at all. But who's donating the money? Like, are they young? Are they old? Are they Jewish? Non-Jewish? Who are the people who are donating the money to these charities in the first place?
Yeah, well, it depends. You can divide it to, so there are like Some of the foundations that forward the money are a foundation of like particular individuals, very rich individuals, such as Irving Moskowitz, based in Miami, actually a physician that built hospitals, but then also built casinos and made a fortune. And he is a big supporter of Jewish settlements, mainly in East Jerusalem. You have several of those kind of people. Then you have one of the biggest organizations called the Central Fund of Israel is a sort of a basket organization. So it would receive donation from basically anybody who is willing to give $250 or more. Impossible to know who gives them the money. Sometimes it would be like big sums from people like Moskowitz or others. But sometimes it would just be like people from the Jewish community who want to support particular causes. And then you also have some Christian evangelical Christians organizations that raise money and support similar causes across the Green Line. So basically speaking, we are talking about like three different groups.
Yes?
Is there a sense in the West Bank that, at least in the southern settlements, that this sort of, funneling of funds is some sort of response against a BDS sort of formation? Is that seen in some sense of opposition to that, or almost like responding to that?
No, I mean, it's a good question, but I didn't notice anything like this, but you have to remember that the data that I used was from up until 2013, and then some of it came from 2014, because there's always a delay with the reports filed to the IRS. BDS movement, while it existed before, it's like becoming bigger and bigger now. I'm sure that, I actually know that there are groups that operate against the BDS, maybe trying to raise money, but Israel is a... So when Netanyahu lost the battle on his fight regarding the Iran deal, he found a new enemy, and this is the BDS movement. And that was the new big threat on Israel. But then over the last months or so, suddenly Israel taking a little bit of different stand, and I think they're saying, okay, maybe we shouldn't talk so much about BDS because we actually make it bigger than it is. So it does have some effect, but I would imagine it's insignificant on the overall.
Yes, in internet studies, there is something known as the Streisand effect. And I don't remember the exact details, but she had a house that people were, it was a really nice mansion in California, I think. People were circulating images of it, and she didn't want that. I don't know, it was an invasion of her privacy or something. So she came out and lambasted, and the whole thing went really viral. Everybody had to see Streisand's house. So there is a little bit of danger if Netanyahu makes fighting, I mean, these small Trotskyite student groups in Britain and so forth, his big enemy. What would happen is that he's turning them into something that maybe giving them more press and attention than they could possibly get on their own. Yes?
Doesn't it seem as though even if this camp gets standing in court, that it still is outrageous enough so that it might get traction in the public eye and begin to be another way to get information to the American public about what's happening with the Israelis and Palestinians? So this issue, even though we don't have standing, maybe there's a way activists can use it.
I leave it to you, Juan.
Well, I mean, I'm glad that they filed that suit. But whether it turns into something or not depends on it being publicized, and it won't be. I mean, there are editors sitting in editorial rooms who decide what gets publicized.
No, but this was actually publicized. I mean, Al Jazeera, English took it, and It was published by Haaretz, and it actually got quite a lot of
traction. Those are the French Foreign Legion of news organizations.
Yeah, that's true. But I would say...
When I mean publicized, I mean that it comes on as one of the headlines on one of those magazine shows on CNN or MSNBC, or it's on the front page of the Washington Post or something like that. Then it will get done, you know, in the news to some extent, but... that's what I, in order for it to have a big impact on public opinion, it would have to be more than that. And being in Al Jazeera probably hurts it. In any case, I think I'm not urging complete pessimism. I think activism around these issues, and the Lord knows, you know, I can show you the bruises. I try to get the word out myself as well as I can as an individual, but all that I'm saying is that having a practical impact on actual policy so that we would meet in 3 years and we would talk about how the IRS revoked the tax benefit for donating to illegal settlements in the West Bank, that I don't anticipate. And it's quite invidious because we have a case where somebody is now serving 60 years in jail for having given charitable monies to Gaza. And it's being argued that, well, everything in Gaza is Hamas. Therefore, the person gave money to Hamas. As far as I can tell, that's not true. The money didn't go to making rockets or whatever, but the FBI came down on this group in Texas of Palestinians a decade ago, like a ton of bricks, and they're in jail. So what they were doing, in my view, was not illegal, and what these people are doing is illegal, but that's why certain people believe in heaven and hell, because it's not all that much justice down here.
But I do want to add something in that regard, because I think like those people can sue and activists can use this information, but I'm a journalist, and for me it was just important to bring the information. Whatever is done with it is like, it really is up to the public or to the reader. I can have my own views, but I do try to and tend to separate them from my work. So, and I think like by not doing so would taint and contaminate this work. So I think we should be careful in asking journalists to become advocates at times.
Yes, in the back.
I just want to say, Uri, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
My question is sort of comes out of the sort of sense of the strange refracted stories that come through the mainstream media to us in Michigan, for example, about what's actually going on in West Bank and so on. And there seems to be this sort of extreme between a sort of deadening litany of death on the West Bank and sort of people going down all the time. And then occasionally a story, getting back to the phrase public opinion, Professor Cole used, about something that is happening possibly in a younger, among a younger generation of Israelis vis-a-vis the politics of the question. I'm just not clear what all that amounts to, if anything. I was just curious, based on your on-the-ground reporting and the kind of perspective you have, what impressions or speculations you might have about younger activists, voters, political conditions, visions that might move things forward.
So you're asking, I'm sorry, I'm not sure
he
I followed.
He wants to know whether there's any hope to be placed in the millennial Israelis, the younger generation. Is that, yes. Do they know more about the West Bank problem, or do they have a different attitude towards it than their elders?
I think there's no hope in that sense, unfortunately. I think people, again, Israel becoming, I mean, you can see it by election results, and yeah, I think like the center does move to the right. So even if political parties like the size of them remains almost the same. It's just harder and harder to say very basic truths. And I think I'll use an example. I talked today in class, and I gave an example of something that just happened 2 days ago. The Israeli chief of staff spoke with high school students. There would be soldiers in a year or two. And one of the students asked the chief of staff about the rules of engagement. And he basically said, like, why the rules of engagement are so harsh? Like, shouldn't you make it easier on soldiers to shoot on attackers? And the chief of staff said something that I thought like was so obvious. He says, look, I don't wanna, you know, like in recent wave of attacks, many times the attackers would be kids, like 13, 14, 15 year old kids coming with a knife or with scissors and try to attack soldiers, border police, officers, etc. And the chief of staff said, look, I don't want my soldiers to empty a magazine, like shoot like a bunch of bullet on a girl that, on a 13-year-old girl that holds scissors. That sounds like the very basic thing, but no, that became a controversial statement by the Israeli chief of staff. And the largest circulated paper in Israel put this controversial, this is the way he defined it, statement as it in its front page, as the headline of the paper yesterday morning, being criticized on the the subtext is like we disagree with you. So this is the sentiment, and people are indoctrinated both in Palestine and in Israel in a certain way that for me unfortunately doesn't leave much place for hope. Sorry.
Yes, sir.
You guys are pretty pessimistic. I guess this is realism. So what I understood is that there is a case being presented against Uri Moskowitz and Sheldon Abelson that did have standing. Are you saying it didn't? And that this was for their particular contributions to the settlements that were avoiding taxation. And that these two guys have been very symbolic of support of the settlements, have a publicity value, but picking up on that, the groups that are looking at Open Hillel, Open Federations, the involvement of the Jewish community, mainstream organizations in support of the settlements or in some of their money is going to the settlements are being encouraged to join in a class action on this. So it does seem that with some encouragement on both sides of the water, that this could get some publicity and some legs and begin to bring the discussion into the Jewish community as to are all these normalized relationships really normal, or are they just supporting an illegality and an impunity that is passing for normal and is one of the great problems morally of our whole time? So is this all gone, or is it not an opportunity to generalize the struggle and the issue about taxing, tax preferences given to these illegal settlements?
I'm not sure which lawsuit you refer to in regard to Adelson and Moskowitz. I would say that from my investigation, Adelson is actually not a known supporter of, there was talk about him donating to Ariel. Couldn't find it yet on records, but it might have been after the years that I've got access to. But Adelson is not known as a big supporter for settlements. He is known for supporting in many other causes in Israel. Many of them can be like right wing, but not necessarily across the green line. I think the other thing that you're referring to is really the involvement of the Jewish Federation, which is at the heart of the Jewish community in the States, are the Jewish federations that represent the Jewry here. And indeed, there is an internal debate within the Jewish community about the federation's support across the Green Line. And some youth movement, in particular J Street U, the university organization of J Street are trying to promote more transparency in the activities of the Jewish federations. They are yet to succeed. That's it. So, like, I mean, there is a debate within the Jewish community about it.
Yeah, I mean, if we're going to look at young people who had a different point of view, it's young American Jews. They, from opinion polling, seem to be quite disturbed by the policies of Mr. Netanyahu.
It depends. I heard some students here who wasn't happy with what I had to say, so I understand it is, again, more complicated, and they're like...
Well, there are all kinds of people in the community, yeah. But I'm just saying is that my own feeling, and again, there's some social science to support this, is that the older generation, support for Israel was just taken for granted. I mean, it was part of one's identity, and they had difficulty accepting the idea of Israel being criticized. And then you have, you know, in the younger generation, a dis-ease about things like the Gaza war, about the constant drumbeat of news from the West Bank, because those young people are more likely to know what's going on.
Yeah, definitely, I think.
And I just see it's not that young people are against Israel or that they don't support it or anything like that. It's just policy, as I said. It's Netanyahu's policy seems to be producing some ideas.
I think many people feel disappointed from Israel, essentially. And especially like the actually older people that maybe were young when Israel was established, and it was like such a victory for the Jewish people to suddenly have a state, really after all they've been through. But they are disappointed because something went down south, something very basically went wrong and became corrupt in a sense. And 1967 is definitely a milestone in that feeling, and they couldn't heal it, and it's just becoming worse and worse. So the older generation maybe remember better, so they still have some, you know, warm, like feeling warm to a certain degree to Israel, but the younger generation, like, they don't know how things felt like 40 years ago, so they have harder time, I would imagine, to relate to the good old-fashioned Israel.
I think it's also contextual in the sense that I remember, I'm old enough, I remember 67, and that was, you know, Syria and Egypt, big countries with Soviet militaries and tanks and planes who, you know, they might have overrun Israel, you don't know. It so happened the Israelis were very good at what they do, and so, you know, the Israeli Air Force had a limited number of planes to fight the Egyptian Air Force. The Egyptian Air Force was pretty good, but they ran it like NASCAR. They would go out for a sortie, they would come back and get serviced really quick, and then they'd go for another sortie. So they were flying two or three times as many sorties as the Egyptian high command estimated that they could. So they just bombed the Egyptian Air Force on the landing strip. They never were able to take off, because the Egyptians thought they had time, the Israelis only had so many planes. And Abdel Nasser came out, the leader of Egypt at the time, and accused Americans of bombing Egypt, because he said, we know how many planes the Israelis have, they couldn't possibly have done this. But he didn't figure with the Israeli engineers and logisticians. But that was a moment where, you know, the Western world was very enthusiastically supporting Israel, and they saw it as a kind of small country being beaten up on by these big Arab countries who were anyway, you know, disliked because they had tilted towards the Soviet Union and the Cold War. But, you know, the image coming out in 2009 or 2014 of the Israeli Air Force bombing this little strip of land where people are kind of trapped, and bombs falling on schools, and, you know, 2,000 civilians killed, and so forth. That's a different image.
Of course.
And now we have social media and television, and it's not like the image can be hidden.
I think part of the problem in 67 was that the hubris, what Israelis felt, they can, you know, they tripled the size of the country within 6 days. They could beat Egypt, Jordan, Syria, and The mistake was on the seventh day, probably.
They should have rested. Yes, one more question. Do you have one, Robin?
No.
You're question. Just saying you're giving us a time up. Yes. There's a question over here, I'm told. Yeah, okay.
Thank you so much, Uri, for this is very enlightening. I'm wondering if you can kind of tell the, I guess, American audience here in this room what your experience has been in trying to engage with this material with mainstream American media. So you know you work with the Post and other news outlets and mainstream media, whether it's in terms of TV. What has your impression been in terms of their interest in engagement with this material?
So I primarily work for Haaretz and write for like Israeli publications, and so to be honest, I can't answer this question so much from a personal experience. As a viewer, I think there is interest in those topics. I think the media here is definitely more balanced than the media in Israel. The problem is, again, for me, the problem is that there is no interest in Israel to know those things. That's the primary problem. So sorry if I couldn't answer this properly, but.
Uri Blau, Juan Cole.
Thank you.